Ladies and gentlemen, welcome. Vaughan, thank you very much indeed for inviting me to come along and speak. I don't know what with all the stuff with Pravin Gordhan in the newspapers would have knocked everything else off the front page, I reckon. Did any of you see the report about the SAA plane in Washington the night before last, it must have been, which had to abort its takeoff because the engine failed? Had its nose up, came down, smashed the wind with the wheels on the one side, and had to be taken in with smoke and ambulance. Yeah, well, that was my plane. So what happened? It was on its way to Accra in Ghana and then coming down here. So not last night, the night before, I got up at 4 and got out to the airport, and they said to us, no, there's going to be a delay until 1 o'clock. So what do you want to do? So I said, all right, we just stay. Okay, there's a whole... Sorry? Yeah, there's an extension of time, yeah. No penalty clauses, though, just an extension of time. You know, it's SAA, there are no penalty clauses. Okay, so we went and we sat in the lounge. And then at 11, they came along and they said, oh, sorry, they'd got the message wrong. It wasn't 1 in the afternoon, it was 1 this morning. They just got the wrong 1 o'clock. So, okay, then they were going to send us to a hotel, all right. So they got a bus. And we got on, but they sent us to the wrong hotel. So we pitched up. We stood in this queue for about 45 minutes, and then there was complete consternation. And they said, no, this isn't the right hotel. It's another hotel, which was a real flea pit somewhere in the back end of Accra. But anyway, we got there. And then as these things do, the time went back from 1 o'clock to 2 o'clock to 3 o'clock. We eventually flew at 4 this morning. So I got in, went up to the hotel, had a shower, took my clothes out. So my clothes are looking crumpled and I'm feeling more crumpled, and came here. And so here we are. So if I fall asleep halfway through this thing, somebody just come and kick me. You've all had lunch and I believe a couple of bottles of wine as well. So I dare say that you chaps keeping awake is going to be a challenge. The after lunch slot is always the challenge anyway. But I've chickened out of standing for an hour. So if you don't mind, I'm going to sit here and talk to you. Is that all right? Good, splendid. Anyway, welcome. It always sounds a bit like advertising, and I'm always a bit sort of slightly awkward doing it, but unless you understand where I'm coming from, it doesn't really help my talking to you too much. So I work for the Royal Institution of Chartered Surveyors in the UK. So RICS, although we're not supposed to call it that, the brand, please say it must be RICS, but everybody ignores them mercifully. It's about 150 years old. It's a royal charter institution, which means that it's a not-for-profit institution. It exists to protect the public against its members, I suppose, just like the Medical Council, the Bar Council, the Law Society, pretty well any other professional body. It does it two ways of doing it. One is by, obviously, regulation and disciplinary side of it, and then the other is through setting standards. So RICS has got about 220,000 members, trainees, and pupils, students, all the way around the world. I lost track. I think it's 47 countries on 6 continents at the moment, something like that. It was, until the turn of the millennium, very much a UK-centric organization. I mean, we've had members here. I think there's about 6,500 RICS members in South Africa, and some of them have been going for a very long time. As a matter of interest, are any of you in the audience RICS members? Respectable showing. You'll keep the side up. Good. Glad to see you. But I mean, there have been some members here for a long time. During the apartheid years, RICS sort of, you know, did the politically correct thing. And so it's only really since 1994, but then particularly since 2000, that RICS has started to really try and develop itself again in South Africa, sub-Saharan Africa, and in the last couple of years we've opened offices in Accra, which is where I was yesterday, or in fact this morning, and Kenya, Nairobi. So we, by 2020, we'll have more non-UK members than UK members, which is quite a mind shift for an organization that's been going since 18, what does this one say? They say 1868, other people say 1862. I think it was sort of never quite sure which year it was, but you know, it's been a long time. So Yeah, that's what it says. I don't need to read that out to you. I never see the point of writing slides and then reading them to people. So in essence, that's what RICS is about. Now, where does dispute resolution fit into all of this lot? Because, I mean, by background, I'm a farmer from the Eastern Cape. I practiced at the Joburg Bar and Innes Chambers for about 12 years. Then, for various family reasons, we went over to the UK, so this is 25 years ago, and I've been involved in various aspects of dispute resolution since. And I head up DRS. Now, I was doing some research for, funny enough, you were talking about Sundra, Datu Sundra Raju this morning, for a conference there with him in KL a little while ago. And I was fishing out some photographs, and I came across, on the internet as one does, and came across a photograph of two surveyors in sort of that grainy daguerreotype type of photograph with suits and theodolite, and it was captioned "Resolving a Boundary Dispute, 1894." So resolving disputes is actually something that surveyors have been involved in for a very, very long time. And remember, when we talk about surveyors within RICS, they are, I think RICS is probably seen in South Africa as being largely QSs and maybe some valuers. But in fact, there are 17 different professional groups within RICS. So it is valuers, QSs, land surveyors, a whole lot of disciplines within construction, some of the new things, sustainable housing, environmental affairs. Then you've got, bizarrely enough, arts and antiques auctioneers are in there because we assimilated their institution some years ago, about 25 years ago, and they say it's never been the same since. Might have a point. Then there is the whole retail sector, so that's the retailers, the estate agents, all of those people. Facilities managers, once anybody works out what FM really means. Contract management. There's a whole series. I mean, there's 17 different professional groups within RICS. So QSing and valuation, which is what you tend to see here in South Africa, is only two fairly small subsets of what we actually involved in. Anyway, apparently in the 70s, solicitors, the British word for attorneys, as you know, those of you who aren't lawyers, started nominating the president of the RICS to appoint an arbitrator in rent review matters. So in other words, you've got a big building, commercial property, and it's got a 25-year lease, which is common in the UK, with a 5-yearly rent review. In the event that the parties can't agree who the arbitrator would be for that rent review, they'd seek the appointment of an arbitrator by an independent third party who was nominated as the president of RICS. Well, apparently, the president of the RICS got this letter and called the honorary sec in and said, "What's an arbitrator?" And that sort of started this process. So in 76, RICS actually established what it called its arbitration service, which then, when we started doing adjudication and mediation and expert determination, all the rest of it, changed its name in the early 80s to the dispute resolution service as it remains today. So we've been going for 40 years. Look, what we're about is that we only function in the built environment. If somebody were to come along to us with a personal injury claim or a family dispute or a, intellectual property dispute, we would politely refer them to some other organization because, frankly, we wouldn't have a clue where to start. But what we do work in is disputes arising in land, property, construction, infrastructure, the built environment, essentially. So everything from boundary disputes to valuation disputes to strata disputes to neighbors fighting over hedges through to major construction issues. So 70% of construction adjudication appointments in the UK come through my office. We are nominated in 99% of all commercial leases in the UK. So we make 99% of the appointments or referrals or nominations, call it whichever one you want to be if you need to be technical, of rent review arbitrators and expert witnesses, depending on what the leases say. So, you know, it's a fairly broad church. All in all, we're working in, well, with Ghana yesterday, it's 18 countries now, because we just trained up some mediators there. So 18 countries around the world. And we appoint, at present, about 7,000 dispute resolvers a year. That's actually down. We were at 10,500 before the financial crash in 2007, 2008. and then it dropped right off. It went right down to about 5,000, and now it's climbed up to about 7 again. So it's sort of slowly starting to reestablish itself. And, you know, we do the whole gamut. So we've got arbitrators, adjudicators, mediators, experts to do expert determination, dispute board members. And in fact, we run two separate lots of training, one for dispute board chairman and one for dispute board members. So that's FIDIC, typically DABs and DRBs. Then there are, what have I missed out, mediators, of course. And we've introduced our own form of mediation now to address the land market. And expert witnesses we've been training up recently. So that's us. So technically, I mean, we are the oldest and the largest built environment specific dispute resolving service in the world now by some distance. So, you know, that's just to tell you who we are and where I fit into it. So I'm in charge of DRS. And here in South Africa, we've been busy now for about 4 years, I guess, DRS, trying to... We started off by training up mediators. We've had a number of arbitrators go through now who've done the international arbitration training. Now they've got to do the conflict delict and evidence components so that they can do domestic stuff as well. We are looking to set up an adjudication training course and run an adjudication panel. And we'll be launching the expert witness training as well here in South Africa. So we're quite busy. The way we work is that the president's all of the appointments made by DRS, with the exception of Scotland, which just has to be different, are made in the name of the president of the RICS. In Scotland, it is in the name of the chairman of the RICS in Scotland, because if we didn't do that, they'd go independent and leave the United Kingdom. Okay? What they're going to do now that oil is at $40 a barrel, I don't know, but you know they're going to have a boom market in haggis and whiskey, and that's going to keep them going, sailing off into independence for the next 100 years. They'll be right there. Okay. People on the president's panel who are appointed, we will either train them up or we'll recognize people who have particular experience and eminence in their professional field, as well as in whatever discipline of dispute resolution they're involved in. They sign a SLA with us, they are subject to our quality assurance, and they get re-interviewed every 3 years, and they have to maintain specific CPD for us. There's a whole gamut of stuff that they are subject to in order to provide that service that we provide. In essence, when we appoint somebody, what we're saying to the public is, A, they know what they're doing in terms of being a dispute resolver, and B, they've got a very, very good background in their specific sector technical expertise. Typically, most of the panel are surveyors, senior surveyors, but we've also got a good sprinkling of barristers and solicitors, in other words, advocates and attorneys, architects, engineers, various other people whose practice focuses on the built environment. So, look, that's where we are. That's what we do. If any of you want to join, just tell me. All right. So, construction disputes. Just to put this in context, and I'm sorry the figures are all UK because I couldn't find the South African equivalent ones. But where we're looking, I'm sure they're there, but I just didn't know where to look. So the current average value of a UK construction dispute is running at about, this is the EC Harris figures, at about £7 million at the moment. So in other words, they're bloody big ones and then smaller ones, but that's sort of your average value. I can't find figures for the financial cost of disputes in the UK construction industry measured in billions of pounds. If I can tell you that what I'm going to be talking about principally this afternoon, because it's all about dispute avoidance rather than dispute resolution, is the scheme that we have created for Transport for London, which runs a London Underground, Costain, Lango, Rourke, Taylor Woodrow, and BAM. They're four major contractors, although you can't call them contractors anymore, they are now project delivery partners. Oh, yes. And one has to be very careful you don't say contractor, because that's not right anymore. Okay. But we've been running the scheme for them now for, it's over 18 months now. So it started January 2015. I've got a 19-year-old son who's about to turn 20. And the little shit, the other week, on that subject, I said, my God, it's August already. Where's the year gone to? He says to me, you know what, Dad? Yeah. He said, when you get to your age, not a good way to start, Robert, if you want any money given to you for booze at university, okay? When you get to your age, your internal processes slow down so much that everything outside appears to go past that much faster. It's all a matter of relativity. Yeah, great, you know, that's what I need. But anyway, so we have, it does take me, it's amazing, we have been going 18 months already with that scheme. We've done, yeah, it was 18 cases last week, but I know there are another three where we're seeking appointments at the moment. We've resolved them going to arbitration or to litigation. 18 matters in that time. Wasn't quite one a month, although it does actually square up. But we are currently at £650 million worth of disputes, which we have resolved using this mechanism in 18 months. And they've just sent a schedule of another 23 matters through to us that they want to come on, which would take it to well over the £2.5 billion worth of disputes, which have all been kept out of the litigation or the arbitration process. So, you know, just to try and get a handle on, that's just one little scheme that we're running for one organization in the UK. So I shudder to think what the total value of construction disputes are in the UK per annum. I mean, it would be in the billions of pounds. When you convert that into rands, it's quite a lot. Even though the rand's got stronger now. But if number one gets rid of Frovin Gordon, I don't know what it will go to after that, but we'll wait and see, won't we? Right, obviously as well, it's not just, you don't just measure the cost of construction disputes in terms of pounds and pence or rands and cents. You measure it in terms of the huge harm that they do to business reputations, brand reputations, trading relationships, all of the rest of that stuff that goes in there, delay and so on. And they can, using, and I'm not just talking about South Africa and Britain now, I've sort of got a slightly wider perspective on it. They can be painfully slow to resolve through traditional means such as courts and arbitrations. I was in Delhi in February, and I was invited to a party to celebrate the centenary of one matter in the High Court in Delhi. It has been running for 100 years, and they had a party to celebrate the occasion. This is the fifth generation of litigants are fighting over this piece of land. Okay, now that is quite an achievement, right? So, okay, I mean, that's possibly on the extreme end, but nonetheless, it takes a hell of a long time to get stuff through. So there we are. Shout if I'm boring you. Okay. So just having a look at these things. So I know that there's some very eminent lawyers in the room, and it's quite hard to pitch a talk where I know I've got silks, and I thought Rob Nugent might still be here, but he's gone. Judges, silks, solicitors, you know, attorneys, advocates, but then people who aren't legal fundi. So I thought, forgive me, the lawyers switch off now and do things on your phone. So basically, the different ways that I just want to have a quick run through. And what I'd like to do, sorry, everyone? Okay. What I'd like to do is just have a quick rip through these. And then also, from our point of view as an appointing agency, sort of on a fairly global level, just give you some of the insight as to some of the problems that not necessarily us, but the people who seek appointments from us and the people in the industry find with these various different types of process. And obviously, the reason I'm doing that is to say, well, a more flexible, bespoke conflict avoidance mechanism is probably better than trying to pursue some of these. So that obviously is the logic of what I'm talking about. So litigation is court. As you know, arbitration is effectively deciding on an arbitrator who fulfills the same role as a judge, but does so privately. Adjudication, it does vary quite a lot from jurisdiction to jurisdiction. It's a short form of dispute resolution mechanism, typically from the launch of the proceedings until the award is given. You're looking at 28 days, extendable to 35, extendable to 42, depending on which country you're in. In the UK, it applies to all construction disputes. In Australia, for instance, it applies only to payment claims by subcontractors on contractors or contractors on clients. It doesn't apply to anything else. But the difference between litigation and arbitration is that the judgment that is given in a trial and the award that is made by an arbitrator is binding and final on the parties, subject to very limited rights of appeal in court cases or taking it on review if it's an arbitration. But essentially, that binds you, and you can't go behind it or take it to another forum to overturn it. Adjudication in most countries, adjudication is binding, but it's not final. That's the point. So, in other words, if you take a claim for payment to adjudication, the adjudicator makes a decision that says, yes, the money's owing, you are obliged to pay the money, subject to an exception that if you can show to a court that the organization to whom it is going to be paid is about to go insolvent and therefore you never stand any chance of getting it back, then you might be able to subvert that. But in the ordinary course of events, it's binding and that you've got to pay it. But then you can take the entire matter to either a court or, if there's an arbitration clause in your contract, to an arbitrator and have it heard from scratch. And the court or the arbitrator will pay no attention to the adjudication at all, certainly won't read the decision, won't take any account of the arguments. They'll hear it from scratch. Clearly, if at the end of that they come to the same, essentially the same decision as the adjudicator, then the adjudicative award will de facto remain in place. On the other hand, they could reverse it, in which case the money would have to be paid back. So that, or if the adjudicator held that the money wasn't owing and the court held that it is, well, then clearly the money has to be paid. But the difference between litigation and arbitration and adjudication is that in litigation and arbitration, the award or the judgment is binding and final, whereas in adjudication, it's binding, but it's interim. And therefore, you can go around it. Okay, that, in essence, is the difference. Expert determination. And obviously, litigation and arbitration, you can apply in any field. Adjudication is pretty well restricted to the built environment and to construction matters. Expert determination, very common in rent review matters, often involving an awful lot of money. Less common, perhaps, in the construction world. But what it is actually putting all your eggs into an expert's basket and saying to the expert, we want you to come and give an award which will bind us. Okay, they make a determination which is binding on the parties. Now, the difference between litigation, arbitration, and adjudication on the one hand, and expert determination on the other, is that in the first three, the judge, the arbitrator, and the adjudicator are bound to give a decision only on the admissible evidence that is presented to them during the course of the proceedings. Okay, there are very limited extents to which a judge can take judicial notice of something that is not in evidence. And I mean, this isn't a treatise on the laws of evidence this afternoon, but those of you who are lawyers will know exactly what I'm talking about. A judge can't go in there and say, you know what, these people are talking rubbish, it's actually this, okay, because I happen to know that. Can't do that. A expert, by contrast, is appointed specifically because he or she has very significant expertise in that particular field, and the parties expect the expert, and in fact the expert, that's their job, is to pay cognizance not only to the evidence that is presented, but to draw on his own or her own background and skills and expert knowledge in reaching a decision. But it is a binding decision if it is an expert determination. Okay, that's the difference. I mean, this business about judicial notice, again, I'm divulging, but I mean, it's a really interesting case last year in UK, nothing to do with property at all, but you know about the whole business about parliamentary privilege, that whatever is said in the House of Commons or in Parliament here, so when Jubjub gets up and does things, you know, in Cape Town, no one can sue him for it. It's only the Speaker can kick him out, and that's it. Similarly, we had a whole issue last year about injunctions and super injunctions. Injunctions are the British name for an interdict. Now, what was happening, that celebrities were bringing injunctions against the press to prevent them from publishing scurrilous stories about rumors about what they had been up to, all right? Generally of a sexual nature. But the point was that it didn't prevent the papers publishing a story about the fact that the celebrity had sought an injunction to prevent them publishing the story. Okay. So on the principle that there's no smoke without fire, the press could do just about as much damage, if not more, because not only did it make the celebrity look as if they were guilty, but it made them look as if they had a guilty conscience too, which is worse, okay? So then some bright lawyer somewhere came up with the idea of a super injunction. And a super injunction was an injunction which prevented the court from even from publishing the fact that the little injunction had been sought in the first place. So in other words, you couldn't tell the story and you couldn't tell the public that the celebrity had sought to prevent you telling the story, all right? Now the trouble was, and I mean it sounds fine, but the trouble was it started to be abused as all these things are, and the rich and famous who could afford the sort of fees that were being charged to take those matters through the High Court were gagging newspapers left, right and center on the slightest pretext, and the whole public interest issue about the press being there to report was becoming subverted by what was going on. But there was bugger all that anybody could do about it because, you know, if a newspaper published the existence of a super injunction, not only would they be sued by the celebrity, but they'd be up for contempt of court. And actually, under English law, the editor would be sent to prison. All right. So the newspapers were nothing they could do about it. And people were very unhappy. It all came to an end when two MPs, with the connivance of the Speaker, stood up in Parliament and read out the list of all the super injunctions that had been applied for and the celebrities that were involved in it. And there was nothing that the courts could do. Now, this is the principle about what's admissible and what isn't. Even though every judge in the country watched it on television, not one judge could do anything about it because it was inadmissible. It's said in Parliament, therefore it's privileged, therefore the judge cannot hear it in evidence. And because the judge can't hear it in evidence, the judge can't rule on it. Ergo, they can do nothing about it. That's the way privilege works. Okay? So you had this extraordinary situation in which every judge watched blatant contempt of court happening on the floor of the House of Commons. I mean, you think Jujube's exciting. I mean, that's got nothing on this at all. All right? Blatant contempt of court, deliberate, open contempt of court, with the connivance of the Speaker happening on the floor of Parliament, could do nothing about it. That is because judges are a creature of evidence. Now, had it gone to expert determination, of course, the expert could probably have ruled, but it doesn't. It goes to the courts, and mercifully, they don't do it. That, you know, illustrates it. Early neutral evaluation is basically where one party or the other party generally come along with their case to an expert, and they say, give us a steer, tell us what you think would happen if we went to court. Okay? And it can be a very, very useful way of getting the reality testing done at a point that the parties can actually settle rather than having to take it on to court. Mediation, I'll talk to you about very briefly again at the end. Mediation is traditionally, the mediator is not a judge, the mediator never tells the parties what to do, the mediator comes, brings the parties together, and by listening, talking, finding out the interests and need, bringing them slowly together, helps them find the mediator is said to be facilitative, and helps them to find a solution to their problems. Okay. It grew out of the work in the Harvard Business School in the 60s and the 70s, looking into collaborative contracting, which is actually what we're talking about today. And you know, once you talk about collaborative contracting between parties, to bring in a third party neutral to help them with that process isn't a particularly big jump. So that's really where mediation came from. I will talk to you about it at the end, because the traditional facilitative mediation process is, we certainly find, with respect, seen as being quite fluffy, not seen as being incisive or hard enough to really deal with the type of disputes that we find in the built environment. So what we have done is that we have gone very much into the evaluative mediation camp, where we are appointing mediators who have 20 years experience in that field and who can bring the parties, knock their heads together and assist them in finding some sort of settlement. So that's the approach that we've taken at RICS, but I'll talk about that a bit later. So those are all forms of dispute resolution, because in each case there is a dispute already existing. Very often it has reached actually quite an advanced stage before the parties try and invoke some form of settlement. So mediation is often brought in at the 11th hour, after they've had a pre-trial conference, after they've tried to have settlement negotiations and failed. But it is premised on the idea that there is a dispute in existence, crystallized to some other extent, which needs to be resolved. On the right-hand side, dispute boards and bespoke methods, like we talk about today, they are methods of dispute avoidance, very often written trendily with a capital D and a capital A. So, FIDIC dispute boards, dispute review boards, dispute adjudication boards, Adjudication boards were generally given interim binding opinion. Review boards given an opinion that generally isn't binding. You've got standing dispute boards and ad hoc ones. The standing dispute boards will typically, three people will be appointed on a dispute board for the duration of an infrastructure contract. They will be on monthly retainer. They have regular meetings. They meet everybody. They read the contracts. They're involved in it. Typically, you'll find an engineer, surveyor, and a lawyer, somebody like that, sitting on the three. Ad hoc dispute boards is where they are brought into being to resolve a particular matter which has come up, which is not entirely the most comfortable fit, because the whole idea is to be there to avoid things growing in the first place rather than bringing people into being only when the dispute has already reached a certain level of maturity. So, you know, we, as I say, we appoint members of dispute boards, we train up, we have training courses for chairmen and for members of dispute boards. So, you know, I'm not knocking it because we do it, but it does have some issues. Then you've got the bespoke methods, which is where I'm eventually going to get to this afternoon after I've done all of this. But I told you I had to talk for an hour and a half, so I'm doing my best to keep you awake. Okay. Here we go. So I said I'd run through some of the difficulties. Litigation. Now, I mean, my background is I'm an advocate. So, I mean, you know, it takes a crook to catch a crook. But still, look, it's slow. It's expensive. Again, as I said, it's restricted to evidence with very limited, I've covered this topic already. There are, in many parts of the world, problems with the quality and the technical expertise of the bench. I mean, you know, let's not be politically correct. I mean, here you had, God, he was the Minister of Justice a couple of ones ago. Damn it, man. It's gone blank on the man's name. This is what comes from not having slept for two nights. Who was the South African Minister of Justice about 3-4 years ago? Sorry? Khadebe. Jeff Khadebe. It was Khadebe. You're right. Jeff Khadebe. Yes, it was. Definitely. Jeff Khadebe caused a real storm by going out in public and saying arbitration is racist. Any of you remember that? Yeah. And it caused a real frisson, as you can imagine, through the dispute resolution community, not just in South Africa, but elsewhere as well. And what the man was talking about was what was perceived as becoming a practice in the courts here in South Africa, by which counsel would appear at roll call in the morning, and in would come the judge president and say, all right, chaps, you ready to go? Yes, my lord, as your lordship pleases. Fine. How long you need? 2 weeks? As your lordship pleases. Good. Well, let's see who's free. Yep. Judge McKenzie's available. He's just had a criminal trial in Pretoria collapse, so he's available for 2 weeks. Go and see him in chambers. As your lordship pleases. And off they toddle to go and talk to Judge McKenzie. All right. On the other hand, Judge Jongilanga is available. Oops. A little pause. And then, would your lordship allow the matter to stand down, sine die, because the parties are considering settlement? And off they go to the arbitrator that they've had on retainer for the one day, just in case they got a judge they didn't want. Now that, I'm not being politically correct, but I mean, that is what was behind Jeff Khadebe's thinking. Okay. And it's not just this country that has had problems with the quality and the experience and the ability of new appointees to the bench to actually discharge their jobs, their business properly. There's many countries around the world. I mean, many countries in the developing world have got real problems with the bench. The Middle East is a case in point, where the real problem over there that we're encountering is the use of expert witnesses who are called by the courts to prepare reports. And then the judges simply read that report and rubber stamp it at the bottom, and that report becomes the judgment. What is probably even disturbing is where the judges feel that they really shouldn't just read it, so they fiddle with it a little bit. And they improve it here and there. And then they hand it down, which is probably even more dangerous. So, you know, please don't think that South Africa is the only country that is experiencing challenges. I mean, we see it as RICS in many, many, many jurisdictions around the world. I mean, the UK, we are incredibly lucky in that we've got the TCC, which is the Technology and Construction Court, which is staffed by judges who are specialists in the construction field and who really know their business. And that has taken the standard of I mean, there's been an interesting dynamic in the UK because arbitration in construction, up until sort of the 1980s, there was a hell of a lot of arbitration of construction matters. Then they introduced the adjudication provisions, and so a lot of it went to adjudication. And actually, because in the UK adjudication is pretty good and is run by people who are very, very competent, and it's very unusual for an adjudication award to actually be overturned, a lot of the work that was going through to the county courts for construction matters suddenly went to adjudication. And a lot of the work that was going to the arbitrators when they, for the bigger end matters, when the TCC was created, then was going through to the TCC, because actually the TCC was cheaper, and the TCC was consistently very, very good in the quality of the decisions that it was given. But if you were to land up, even in the UK today, with a construction issue, and you landed up in the Queen's Bench, or you landed up somewhere else, for whatever reason it might be, it's even there, it's a bit of a lottery as to who you're going to get hearing your case, and you know just how capable that person would be as a judge in understanding the technical nature of the contractual matters. So you know, it's not a developing world, first world divide either. It's really in the construction sector, infrastructure sector, property sector. It's often very much a function of the narrow and very technical nature of disputes that we actually encounter in this sector, and the ability of a generalist judge who has to deal with criminal matters, civil matters, personal injury matters, heaven knows what, family matters, sort of as they find themselves on the roll, to deal with those sort of things properly. So that's one of the things with judges. It can lead, as I said, to an overdependence on experts. Also, you do find, and I mean, I remember this from practice, I had a number of colleagues who were able to spin any matter out for at least an extra 50% of its time on all sorts of procedural and jurisdictional points, and that really occupies the court because the court has no choice. Now, if somebody comes and raises a jurisdictional issue, you've got to deal with it. And, you know, what the parties in a construction matter want is a decision that's going to help them get on with it, stop the delays, get the payment flowing, get the money moving down through the client contractor, subcontractor cascade. And the last thing they want is time being taken up by learned lawyers and judges arguing, you know, ever smaller points of procedure and intricate legalese. But the courts have no choice. If the matter's raged, they've got to deal with it. Yeah, and I mean, the other point, and this is really more a comparison with things like mediation and conflict avoidance, is that very often you find that an issue has arisen at some point in the past. It's been crystallized into a dispute. You know, letters of demand have been written. Pleadings have been drafted. Expert reports have come in. The whole thing has grown and grown and grown like topsy. Now it gets to court. The only thing a judge can do, or an arbitrator can do, or indeed an adjudicator can do, is hear evidence as to what happened about something at some point in the past, and there will be at least two versions. We'll decide purely on the balance of probabilities, in other words, what was more likely, or what sort of combination of those two is more likely to vaguely resemble the truth. Having made that decision, here's argument as to which law applies to that, then applies the law and gives a decision. But the entire process, quite correctly, is focused retrospectively on something that happened at some time in the past, often a good number of years ago. In the meantime, the two parties have continued trading with each other. They've got more and more work. They're doing more and more stuff. Really, what they want to do now is to go into a JV and go to Zambia and start building shopping centers. But if I stood up in court and I said, you know, my lord, what the parties really want to do is to go to Zambia and build shopping centers, he'd say, well, is that in papers? I said, well, no. I can't hear you quite correctly, because the current commercial objectives, ambitions, what the parties really want to do is entirely inadmissible in any of the, you know, arbitration, adjudication, litigation processes, because they just can't hear it. And so what you land up is a huge amount of energy, time and being spent on resolving a particular point, when in fact what the parties might be happy to do is just to sort of wrap it all up in what they're going to go and do in the future, and save all that money and time and energy. So again, it's one of the problems. where, going back to a point I made a moment ago, and I know I'm rambling a little bit here, but it is relevant to this, I was saying that there was, until the 1980s, a lot of arbitration in the construction sector in the UK. Then it was replaced effectively by adjudication on the one hand and the TCC on the other. What's happened since the Wolf reforms, and as those Wolf reforms, that's the civil procedure rules reforms in the UK, there's been a number of changes under the Wolf reforms in terms of front-loading your litigation process. So you now have to predict, before the trial begins, exactly what expert evidence you're going to need, how much it's going to cost you, and you are then bound by that prediction. And if during the course of the trial you discover that you actually need a hell of a lot more, well, you can, but at your own cost. It doesn't become cost in the court. So there's been rather a lot of resentment about that particular development. Similarly, the courts have now introduced massive court charges. So it's 20,000 sterling a day now. Just court charges, that's what the fiscus takes in for having your case in the TCC. So that's a lot of moolah, okay? It, depending on some of the cases, I think it's the top end of it, but it's a lot, okay? So once again, you're starting to now see interest in arbitration back in the construction and engineering sectors. And in fact, we last year in November launched an RICS arbitration service for the construction sector. And it's a two-level one. One is high-level matters, and we've got some very, very good people there on that bench. We appointed Francis Kirkham, who was judge of the TCC, to a matter only a couple of weeks ago. And then we've got a quick short form version for small matters under £50,000. And we're finding a lot of take up of those because people are avoiding adjudication and avoiding the TCC, which has become quite expensive and very restricted in terms of the CPR rules now, in terms of how you do things. Arbitration, many of the same issues. Now, what we find is that there's often a lot of resistance to the idea of putting in a panel of three, but quite a lot of the arbitration institutions will insist on a panel of three, and sort of de facto, that's where the parties land up having to do it and to pay for that. And arbitrators are expensive, especially internationally, where they get flown over first class, put up at five-star hotels, and, you know, costs a lot. There's India, for instance, is a particularly bad example where arbitration is almost entirely the preserve of retired judges. Judges seem to retire at about 50 on full salary, but then they need to top up their income by doing arbitration. And all they do is continue to run the arbitrations exactly as they ran their court cases as a judge. And do they really have all the expertise and the specific? I mean, arbitration was seen as a way of getting sector-specific expertise into resolving a dispute without a hell of a lot of legalese, talking the same language as the parties, getting it done quickly and efficiently. In most countries, with respect to my colleagues, it has become legalized far too much, and it is actually the essence of what arbitration was about has become lost in this over-legalization, over-judicialization of it. So that's a problem. There's also a problem in many countries that arbitrators, as opposed to judges, just let cases run far too long. And, you know, you stand up in court and you start going on, and if you've got a good judge, they'll say to you, I understand that, thank you, Mr. Fletcher. What I wanted to talk to you about is this paragraph in your particulars. Now, address me on this point. Okay, they get through it. Arbitrators in many countries seem to take the view that they are paid to be there, they're being paid by the day, they're being paid by the hour, and they don't want to appear to cut anybody short. And anyway, why should they? Because they'd be cutting their fees down. And they sit there and these things run and run and run and run and run. Again, India's a case of example. I was talking to two parties at an infrastructure conference in Hyderabad a little while ago, and there were two major infrastructure parties who were there bemoaning an arbitration between them, which was being run by an arbitrator who was running 72 matters simultaneously. Okay? So if for any reason you didn't get your date in front of the arbitrator, you were looking at 6 months before you got another day in front of the arbitrator, if you were lucky. Well, yeah, that is utterly defeating. You're not going to get that with a judge because the JP is going to organize the role. They just can't take on more and more cases because there's no financial incentive for them to do it. easy life when you get appointed to the bench. You don't want more cases than you can have. But an arbitrator, for every case he does, he gets paid. And therefore you can run 72 of them simultaneously. But how the hell does anybody apply his mind properly to 72 matters running simultaneously? It doesn't happen. So, you know, the sort of global perspective that we have on this thing, there's some significant horror stories in some parts of the world. Okay. Talking about horror stories, adjudication. Now, the Australian situation is one which really is worrying. So, one of the problems with adjudication is that it is time limited. So you've got, under the, certainly the UK Act and the Australia Act and the Hong Kong Act and the Singapore Act, you've got 28 days initial period from appointment to award, can be extended by 1 week or 2 weeks with one party's permission, by, you know, or both parties appointing. But by 42 days, that award has got to be made. Now, if you, what is happening? Let me put it this way. We have to keep staff on at RICS, at DRS, between Christmas and New Year, because that is the most popular time to serve adjudication papers. Okay? Now, the reason that's the most popular time is that you take a year to put your claim together, and it runs into files and files of documents. Then you serve it on the 23rd of December, and the other side's got a week to respond. That's under the English Act, and the Australian one is much the same. Now, I mean, that is litigation by ambush. All right, generally people know that the adjudication is coming, and generally, in fact, they will have done the preparation beforehand. But nonetheless, that's a shocking abuse of the system. We as an appointing agency have no choice. I mean, we've, you know, if we're appointed, we appoint. And as I say, we keep staff on. Somebody gets the short end of the stick in the office, and they are available between Christmas and New Year, specifically because we know that a lot of these buggers will be there serving papers and giving the other side a week to respond. And if they don't respond, they're out of time. Okay? So that's one of the problems. The other problem is that it's the Australian situation. Now, I'm faced, here I sit. We make a lot of appointments in Australia. We make a lot of appointments in Britain. Now, to get onto the president's panel in the UK as an adjudicator, you have to do, unless we recognize similar training or experience from somewhere else, but you have to do an 18-month distance learning diploma, which is equivalent to a university master's level on Ofqual. Okay? That's what you have to do. That's the minimum to get onto our adjudication panel for us to consider you appropriately qualified to adjudicate. In Australia, the legislation says you have to have 2 days training. So how do you balance those two? All right? 18 months on our side, 2 days in Australia. I've got to be terribly careful that I don't say something that's slanderous here, but there was an institution in Queensland that was Brisbane, that was, let's just say it was alleged that it had a reputation that so long as you paid their fees, they would find in your favor, all right, if you're a claimant. Let's just put it that way, okay? This reputation was so well perceived in the market, rightly or wrongly, I have to add, that the Queensland government director of adjudication last year cancelled all private sector adjudications and took the entire, he de-established all private adjudication nominating authorities, and he took the entire process back into the civil service. Such was the concern of the Queensland government at the abuses that were going on. Right? And of course, the other problem was that a hell of a lot of these adjudicators, with the greatest respect, were not particularly bright, not particularly competent. They'd done the two-day training, and they, you know, had come from a construction background, and they reckoned that they were up for the job. Well, they weren't, to the extent that the government intervened. So that was a massive scandal. You've got all the other state governments in Australia watching very, very carefully what's going to happen now. So far, it's only Queensland that's done it, but there's a very real possible that New South Wales and Western Australia might follow suit. So we are sitting on tenterhooks. We've pushed our training up. We're trying to try and distinguish our people. But, you know, when you're fighting in a market in which 2 days training is the norm, it's quite hard to distinguish yourself without becoming uncompetitive. I mean, if we said in Australia you had to do 18 months training, I mean, they'd laugh at us. You know, why would they want to? So it's quite difficult from our point of view. South Africa, I don't know what Rob Nugent said about the jurisdictional, what is he talking about, the audi alteram partem, natural justice in adjudication. So long as you hear both sides, and so long as you don't have any conflicts, so that you meet both audi alteram partem and nemo iudex. I mean, I've never thought of it as being a massive thing. I think the point that he was making is that adjudicators need to be robust, not listen to all the technical stuff and just get on with the job. And I agree with him 100% on that, because they are far more powerful than they generally think. Of course, one of the challenges here, as we've seen with the whole thing being put on board, is that the state has worked out, well, actually, if you empower people to do adjudication for claims for payment in construction, we're probably one of the biggest non-payers. So that's a little bit awkward, you know? So we wait to see what's going to happen there. Expert determination, again, dependent on the individual talents and characteristics of the expert. The procedure is far more flexible, and we do find it leaves an awful lot in the hands of the expert, and perhaps it almost goes too far in that direction. Some of the checks and balances that are in litigation and arbitration aren't there, and it can be quite damaging. Early neutral evaluation, well, I mean sort of slightly limited applicability, as I said to you before, in terms of resolving disputes. Mediation, covered this. I'll talk to you about that later. Dispute boards, DRBs and DABs. I was at the Dispute Board Federation, DRBF, Dispute Board Resolution Federation, in Singapore a couple of years ago. Very American, very Australian, I discovered, body. I hadn't quite realized that. And they were making the point that it doesn't matter how expensive your three-man panel is, it doesn't matter what their fees are, it doesn't matter what the length of the infrastructure project is, there is never a single example in which the DRB's fees have even amounted to 1% of the project fee. And it is absolutely money well spent. I take that argument. To the point that we appoint, DRS, we appoint dispute board people, we train them up. But that perception is not shared universally amongst the people who want to use them. So I was sitting down in Cape Town next to the General Secretary for General Electric Africa and was talking to him about dispute boards, and he said, we won't use them. I said, well, why? He said, no, too expensive. I said, but hang on. He says, no. He said, we're not going to pay three people on full salary for retainer to sit there for 10 years for the extent, for the length of a project, just on the off chance that something might happen. Okay. When we did this project that I talked to you about with Costain, Lang O'Rourke, Taylor Woodrow, BAM, and Transport for London, none of them were interested at all in FIDIC DBs. Didn't want to hear about it. What they wanted, and their big concern was this, they were saying, look, if you've got three people sitting on a dispute board, typically, as I said, an engineer, a surveyor, and a lawyer, if you look at the wide range of types of dispute that could potentially arise over, as those projects are, that's the extension of some of the tube lines, the refurbishment of a number of the stations, and the creation of pedestrian links between the cross rail tunnels going through and the tube. The number of different types of dispute, soil mechanics, geology, water, electricity, civil engineering, electrical engineering, construction, quantity surveying, working out surveying where the tunnels are going to be, accounting issues, legal issues, labor issues. To expect three people, however brilliant they might be, to actually have the range of knowledge which would allow them adequately to deal with all of those disparate types of dispute, they took the view that it was unrealistic. And the fear was that in reality they would simply end up relying on experts, and that you would go back to something that was more akin to arbitration or litigation than actually to dispute avoidance, which is what they wanted. So, I'm not commenting on the rights and wrongs of this, I'm simply relaying to you the concerns and the reservations that some people have got about these various types of dispute resolution. So, moving on. So the bespoke approach. What people were looking for was, and here I will go through these heads, so they were looking for a contractual mechanism to avoid and control disputes. They wanted something that focused on preventative techniques, including incentives to encourage cooperation. So in other words, as part of this collaborative, you couldn't see it in if you look at your traditional dispute resolution clause, you know, it might say the parties will go to executive resolution between the MDs or the CEOs, and if that doesn't work, then they might go to arbitration or whatever it might be. Or they might go to mediation first, failing that, they'll go to arbitration. Or they might go from something to litigation or whatever it might be. But it sort of sits there on its own, not really integrated into the rest of the contract, which is dealing with the delivery of the specific aspects of this major project that you're involved in. What they were wanting was to actually incorporate elements of the dispute avoidance mechanism into the type of incentives that would be put into the contract to prevent wastage of time, prevent matters escalating to the point that there would be an interruption of the payment process. And they wanted somehow the whole thing to be in there so that there was an obligation of people to try and identify the issues, deal with them, and if they did, there would actually be incentives by way of the fact that there would be no penalties. And it was a really bit of complex thinking that was going on to bring those dispute resolution clauses, which traditionally have sort of sat out a little bit on their own, buried in chapter 17 of FIDIC or wherever they might be, chapter 9, to bring them into the bespoke collaborative contractual matrix that they were talking about at the bottom, so that it was seen to be part and parcel of the actual contract delivery process. Whether we succeeded in that or not, I'm not sure. That seems to be working, touch wood, quite well so far. It provides an equitable risk allocation and encourages early resolution. This issue of risk is absolutely paramount to all of the people. And if you deal with the people in the Middle East, and we've been talking to Ashgal in particular at the moment, relating to the 2022 World Cup, which somehow, despite set blatter, they still have retained. But then the Russians have kept the one before then, so they've done quite well too. I wonder if all the soccer players will be kicked out on doping. That'll be interesting. We'll see. Okay. This business of risk allocation is huge in all of these people. And I think we're talking DRS. I've got to be back in Doha, October. We're talking to Ashgal about something similar. The other challenges there with the way in which the Middle East, nobody can take a decision, as it has gone up to His Highness the Emir and then has come down again, but that's another matter. But they sent us their standard terms and conditions, which they impose on any contractor who comes to work for them. It ran to 150 type pages of the most dense and incomprehensible legalese I have ever had the misfortune of reading. God knows who they got to draw that up. But there were 17 pages in the middle relating to dispute resolution. That dispute resolution involved five separate mechanisms, each of which was non-binding, and each of which, if it didn't work, sent you to the next mechanism. So there was the engineer, and then the engineer talking to the other side, and then it went through to the CEO, then it went to some sort of mediator, then it went to some sort of adjudication process, then it went to some sort of arbitration, then it went to the courts, it went to the courts. But what was bizarre was that not one of those processes actually resolved the matter finally. So each one was designed to kick it on to the next. Or better still, they were festooned with tripwires designed, if you fail to get a document in within such and such a time, or you fail to take this step properly or that step, then you were sent to the Qatari courts. Now the Qatari courts hear matters in Arabic, apply Sharia, and are, with the greatest respect, staffed by cousins of the Emir. So you can understand why contractors or project delivery partners are not overly enthusiastic at the idea of landing up in front of the Qatari courts, and they regard that as a very significant risk. So the response is that you then up your tender price by 30% so that you roll the risk into your tender price so that you know probably if there's a dispute is going to happen, you'll never get your money, so you charge it up front. And when oil was sitting at, $120 a barrel. The Qataris weren't particularly concerned about this. Since it's come down and money's short and they are retrenching large sections of the civil service, and somehow they haven't made any provision for the 7 lean years after the 20 fat years, suddenly now the Prime Minister's office said to Ashgal, you'd better do something about this, boys, because this risk allocation is wrong. Therefore, what they are talking to us about is putting some sort of mechanism in there in which that risk is allocated between the contractors and the client, which is Ashgal or the Qatari government, on a slightly more equitable way. And one way of doing that is to ensure that you've got either a dispute resolution process, which is going to give you a fair, equitable result, or better still, you stop it ever getting to that point by having a dispute avoidance mechanism in place, which means that the matter can be sorted, damped down, a good, solid, commercial, pragmatic decision given, and the project can get on without the risk and the damages taking place in the first place. So, you know, it's what is really great is to see the change of thinking in a place like Qatar, which is not known for its flexible approach to business, to see that sort of change of thinking coming into being and to see the level of governmental underpinning of this sort of idea, which is quite a credit to them as a country. Again, dealing with the issue about the DBs, you know, can be standing or pay as you go. Provides for issues to be reviewed by an independent panel. We've called the Conflict Avoidance Panel because CAP's quite a nice acronym, which makes non-binding recommendations and encourages party to take ownership of issues. CAP recommendations are reasoned and parties who decline. So let me just depart from the slides and tell you what we've actually done with Transport for London. I've been going for a while now. We went down to London between September 2014 and Christmas, and we sat with the representatives on other. Curiously enough, it wasn't really the lawyers. We were busy working with the project delivery people, the people who actually had to get the work done. And in fact, there was a degree of resistance from certainly Transport for London's lawyers, but also some of the other contractors' lawyers, although less so. Who saw this as being some mechanism that was encroaching on their territory, as it were. So there was quite a lot of pushback from them. But essentially, we went and we spoke to them. And now what they wanted was a panel of experts who would know about the project, who would have a top-notch understanding of all the technical issues which one could sort of sit down, and we did this exercise trying to predict all these various areas in which disputes would arise, and who would be available, you know, reasonably short notice, to be appointed as either a one-man or a three-man CAP to come and deal with these matters. Now, so what we did is that we set up this mechanism. So firstly, we identified, it was just over 30 people, Silks, very senior engineers, very senior experts in all of those fields, who were acceptable to all five parties. And trying to get something when you've got to please five people around the table was a challenge, as you can imagine. We were slightly forestalled on this because they nabbed half a dozen of the experts that we discovered and appointed them as consultants for various aspects of the things that we wanted to do. So we lost a fifth of the panel before we even began, but there wasn't much we could do about that. And the way the system works is that, and this is all written into the contract, but the way the system works is that if either the contractor or TfL on any particular aspect of this project recognize that there is a dispute in the making, something brewing, so long as certain criteria are fulfilled and they're not particularly high, they can then invoke the CAP project. So the magic of this was that this was all agreed to right at the beginning when everyone was involved in this collaborative contracting process, where there was a great deal of bonhomie and optimism about the way this was all going to work over the next 10 years. So that when they do fall out with each other or begin to fall out with each other, they can then invoke the services of an independent third party of some standing, RICS, and we then independently move the process forward from that point onwards. So that was the sort of thinking behind it. So when something arises, we get certain papers in from the parties defining what the issue is. On the strength of the complexity and the quantum, we either appoint a one or a three-man panel. In fact, we've yet to appoint a three-man panel. So all of the ones that have been dealt with so far, we've used a one-man cap. And we match the nature of the dispute to the expertise of that individual. They then are seized with the matter, and they've got 28 days initially, although this is an objective timetable, and it has been extended a couple of times. It's not as tight as the Adjudication Act. But they've got 28 days to read the papers, meet with the parties, meet with both sides, read the experts' reports. They are entitled, if they choose, to call their own expert witness, which is then paid for by the parties. And in essence, what they are doing is that they are using a very robust form of mediation to begin with, to try and get agreement on as much of the issues in dispute as they possibly can so that they are sorted. But as is inevitably the case on those issues on which there is not agreement, they then give a recommendation in writing. Now, I'll show you some sort of little examples, but such is the quality of the people that we're appointing that those recommendations read every bit like a TCC judgment. They have been very, very well done. Now, there was a lot of to-ing and fro-ing in the negotiation phase about what the status of that recommendation should be. And because there's no rules here, we could make it be anything we wanted. So one or two of them actually wanted it to be binding so that there was no faffing about. That was it. You know, what you were told to do, you did. But we didn't get consensus on that. What there was consensus on was that the agreement needed to have teeth. And so we came up with something which is novel, and which I think quite pleased with, actually, which is that it was agreed that if the recommendation is made and a party disagrees with it, that party can't simply knee-jerk it away. They have got 2 weeks in which to provide fully justified reasons in writing as to why they're not going to be bound by it. The next question that arose out of that was what would the status of those reasons be if they then went to arbitration or they went to litigation in terms of an argument on costs? Would it be admissible as to costs or would it not be admissible as to costs? To be honest, we never bottomed that out because we couldn't get five people to agree on it. And then the project started. As I say, touch wood, 18 matters have gone through. Every single recommendation has been accepted and followed by the parties so far. So we haven't had to actually put it to the test. I dare say at some stage we will have to put it to the test, but as things stay at the moment, I don't think there's any agreement as to admissibility as to costs onwards, unless somebody got really clever and made it a with prejudice offer at that point and just put it in formally in terms of the normal CPR. But that is completely uncharted territory still because it hasn't happened as yet. And as I say, we've got another 23 matters coming through now. So we'll see what happens. But you know, if you try and work out what's the essence of a cap, you know, what's the zeitgeist of it? Well, they recognize the inevitability of conflict. It's a pretty grown-up approach. You're not going to have £7 billion worth of infrastructure projects over 10 to 15 years, which is what this is all about in London, without some conflict occurring somewhere. It's going to happen. The idea is to be realistic and pragmatic, to involve the parties and establish in an early stage how the agreements will be handled. That's rooted in the collaborative stage. So there's clarity about how the agreement's going to be dealt with. Focus in minds on solving problems rather than emphasizing differences, and early enough to avoid the escalation to full-blown disputes. I mean, that is really the underlying philosophy behind it. Here we go, I've talked to you about that. Talked to you about this. So I'm not going to read that out. I mean, we got hoist a little bit by our own petard on one matter. It related to the way they dig these tunnels under London is that it's largely through London clay, which is a sedimentary, so it's quite soft. My wife's a geologist, so I mean, I was given a lecture on this. My wife is the only person who, going down to Cape Town, drives around, what's the name of the road between Hout Bay and Fishhook? Chapman's Peak. drives around Chapin's. The last time we went around, there were four of us in the motor car. Three of us looking out past the Sentinel, looking out over the sea, trying to see whales and stuff. One person going, "Do you see the discontinuity between the shales and the granites?" Okay, completely ignoring the view on that side of the motor car. We were in Australia at Easter, and we had to do a little 16-hour trip from Perth to Shark Bay so that Juliet could see the stromatolites. Now, the stromatolites are blue-green algae. They look like little black rocks, but they are the only living example of the oldest fossil on the planet. Okay? There are plenty. I mean, if you go from here to Barberton, you go through hills where there are stromatolites in the cuttings, all right? But they're dead. These ones are alive. And it would have been a 16-hour round trip, except that we got there on Holy Thursday, and we picked up the car at the airport in Brisbane, which is in South Perth, and we had to get all the way through Perth and then head up the coast on Holy Thursday at the beginning of the Easter weekend. It took us 4 hours to get from the airport across the river and up to the northern suburbs, and then we still had to drive all the way up. The last hour was spent at 2 o'clock in the morning dodging kangaroos with no insurance on the hire car, because you're not allowed to drive them after dark. We just crossed fingers and hoped for the best. But that was so that Julia could go and see the stromatolites. So that's what comes from being married to a geologist for 25 years. Fitz University PhD, dangerous. This dispute was all about the self-lintling capacity, because all they do is they shove this bloody great big thing through the clay, which hollows out this massive big tube, and then they take gunite and they spray it over the tube to secure it. I dare say I'm doing a disservice to the engineers that have organized this, but in essence that's what it is. And depending on how strong the clay is and how it can self-lintle, you need one layer of gunite or two or three or whatever it might be to hold it in place. And so this dispute was all about, I think we've got an example here, this dispute was all about whether the self-lintling capacity of this particular stretch of clay fell within the parameters that had been defined within the contract, and if it didn't, it was a compensation event. If it did, it wasn't. And obviously, TfL was saying one thing and the contractors were saying the other, and so we brought our bloke in. Now, what, in terms of the rules, the Conflict Avoidance Panel does not have to tell the parties what to do. It's perfectly open for it to say, look, this is the issue. On the evidence that you've given me so far, or the evidence that is available to you, there is insufficient detail to actually make a finding, because neither your expert nor your expert have really covered the essential bits. So you go away and you go and get the expert evidence. When you've got it, come back to me. And that's the finding that he made. And they weren't happy at all. There was lots of rumblings about that, because they thought they were going to be told what to do. So we had to say, okay. So we reappointed him, and he went back, and then he actually called his own expert evidence. He commissioned his own expert evidence on these particular points that he had defined. The two parties ended up paying. They were quite happy about that. And then when having received it, he then made a finding on that basis, and they were happy. But it's odd that even at that level, what people are wanting is to be given a decision, a pragmatic, commercial, sensible decision. Almost, they're less bothered about the rights and wrongs of the decision, but it's getting the decision is the thing that they actually want, so they can bloody well get onto the project and that they can get moving again. So it's really an interesting dynamic that we've sort of come to encounter in this whole area of stuff. Purpose of the cap procedure, all of this is sort of fairly obvious in what I've said already. Promote open, honest communication, identify disputes early, blah, 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 encourage compromise. I've talked about that. Demonstrate genuine willingness by the client and prevent the need wherever possible. All of that we've talked about. Our role, I think I've told you about this already. Essentially we administer the process, so we keep it on time, we make sure that people deliver what they're supposed to have delivered, we make sure that the person we appoint is available, has the necessary expertise, we do all the conflict checks to make sure that there's no conflict of interest anywhere involved in that. We monitor their performance. They undergo quality monitoring checks. They are required to maintain CPD with us. They are required to be, they were all interviewed before they were appointed. They will need to be interviewed once again every 3 years to make sure that they are still up to date. They are subject to our independent complaints procedure. I mean, what DRS does is that obviously being part of our ICS, where members of the any panel are members of our ICS, if there's a complaint which goes to their professional conduct, we send it over to regulation who deal with it. But, and if they aren't members of our ICS, part of the service level agreement they signed with us is that we have the authority to refer them to the engineer ICE's disciplinary board or REBA's disciplinary board if they're architect or to the bar council or whatever it might be. But in fact, we also at DRS have our own complaints procedure because our test is different. Regulation in any of those organizations look to see, is this a disciplinary offense which could, the ultimate sanction would be to kick them out of the professional organization. Our question is different. Our question is, have they behaved in a way which undermines our confidence in appointing them to represent the RICS as a presidential appointment? And it's a much tighter test. Well, we had two blokes last year that the High Court kicked out as, well, they removed them from office as adjudicators. Well, one they removed, the other they said, either you remove yourself or we'll remove you. Both of those, we handed them over to regulation. Regulation effectively gave them both a slap on the wrist. Then they came back to us. One of them is now having feedback obtained from everybody that he deals with during the course of it, and that will last until his next reassessment interview. And the other one is coming up for his interview with us in a couple of weeks' time. So, you know, there's a degree of quality assurance, administration, making sure that the process is kept on time. There's a customer charter which anybody who acts for us has to sign, which relates to a transparency as to their fees. We're not capping the fees, but everybody needs to know upfront what they're going to charge, roughly an estimate of what those fees are going to be, so that people know what they're letting themselves in for. So there's all of that sort of comes as part of the package. Talk to you about this. They can introduce their own alternatives. Talk to you about that. In this particular one with CAP, they're not binding, but as I said, there's nothing to say that, for instance, we're talking now to Network Rail, we're talking to the Thames Tunnel people, we are starting to talk to HS2, although they are still playing musical chairs with their staff. It's not to say that in any of those other infrastructure projects they may decide that they actually want it to be binding. Okay. I talked about the reasons. Costs. The decision has been that East Party pays its own costs. We have a specific contract with TfL to provide it. Therefore, TfL, we'll charge TfL. TfL recovers half the costs from the other party. But again, there's nothing in stone about that. Everything's confidential. They sign up to that. And clearly things are without privilege, except where there is specific exceptions to remove it. So that case that I was talking to you about, I mean, the way it was phrased, and, you know, just in case you think this is a really sort of woolly, soft process, it ain't, because that's the way it was phrased. The applicant seeks a recommendation by the CAP that the parties resolve the dispute on the basis that, one, a compensation event was not notified in accordance with the clause in the works contract and therefore is time-barred. Two, alternatively, no compensation event has occurred in relation to the ground conditions discovered, which is what we were talking about, and further, the respondent therefore is not entitled to any change in the price, the key dates, and the completion date. So, you know, it's hard stuff that we're dealing with here. Just a couple of extracts from some of the judgments. I said judgment because they read like judgments, the recommendations. So he's looked at a whole series of documents, and he's gone through them. Referral from the applicant, responding party's reply to the responding party's response, further particulars, rejoinders. We didn't get to rebuttals and surrebuttals, but I dare say it'll happen one day. CAP approach to documentary stuff. I'm just sort of showing you the formality under which this operates, that it's not a Mickey Mouse process at all. Basically, they've given a hell of a lot of documents. He's read the ones that he thinks are necessary, and he's going to talk about those. He's had experienced engineers as experts, and pretty high-level people as well. And so that's what I wanted to talk to you about on the CAP process as we've done it. So we're talking to quite a lot of other organizations. It's something that we would like to explore here in South Africa, obviously, or in Southern Africa, to try and see whether we could do it. I dare say, looking around this room, we'd see quite a lot of people who could serve on it. And in this gathering alone, there's a hell of a lot of expertise sitting here. So expect a tap on the shoulder at some stage from us as we move into this. I was talking to you earlier, though, about mediation. And I mean, what we've found is, I'll wrap up on this. What we found is that there's a lot of suspicion, disenchantment, disillusionment with the traditional type of facilitative mediation, which, and I don't want to do it a disservice, but I was trained as a mediator by ADR Group, which is the very old, well, it's the oldest mediation service provider in the UK, but it's a generalist one, so it does labor, it does community, it does family, it does commercial as well. But the whole mediation thing was premised on the idea that you didn't have to have any particular expertise in the field of the dispute, because anybody could be a mediator because you were being facilitated rather than determinative. You didn't have to read the papers in the case because, again, it was up to the parties to tell you the story. And then you came along and you never gave them the advantage, dubious perhaps in some instances, of your thoughts on a matter. You would hear what they said, you would listen to them, you would try and identify their interests and needs, you would give people an opportunity to vent, to become acknowledged, all of these soft skills. And then somehow out of this, a settlement would emerge. Now the fact is that has been running now since the 60s and 70s, we now are nearly at 2020, so nearly 60 years. You've seen that model of mediation running, and it has been highly effective in many, many places. So I'm not knocking it. But all I can tell you this is we, in the 2014-15 financial year, and it wasn't any different this last one, we received precisely 3 applications for that sort of mediator. Every application that we get comes with a list of skills, experience, background, particular knowledge that they want the mediator to have, and that comes in from both parties. And the question is, I mean, to give you an example, we appointed last year in Saudi a big petrochemical plant which had things on the roof that move to protect it from the sun, and they weren't moving as they were supposed to. So they wanted someone who understood FIDIC NEC and the particular type of bastardized contract that they were using quite commonly in the Gulf and in Saudi. They wanted someone who understood mechanical engineering, a petrochemical background. They wanted someone with QS knowledge because there's going to be a rebuild. They wanted a mechanical engineering knowledge, and they wanted the person to have had 20 years experience in the Gulf and be fluent in Arabic. Okay, so, yeah, as one does. Well, given that the client was a scion of the royal family who had been educated at Harvard, and who didn't have any problem speaking English, given that the contractors were a consortium of Danish, Chinese, and Americans, none of whom spoke Arabic, we sort of dispensed with that last requirement. But we found people who more or less ticked the other boxes. And one was in Australia, one was in Scotland, one was in Dubai, and I think we ended up appointing the Australian, actually. But if you read this contract, it wasn't the sort of classic one-day commercial mediation where the person sits down to the two parties and listens. There was a one-month mediation period provided for, and they clearly expected the mediator to go from one side to the other, meet the experts, read the reports, visit the site, try and work out what was wrong, and then in the subtext was give a recommendation telling the parties what to do. Okay. Now that is not a classic mediation's backside, but nonetheless that is what the parties wanted. And for us to turn around and say, oh, well, you can't have that because that's not classic mediation, I mean, it would be madness from our point of view. So we've had to revisit our entire approach to mediation. And we've sort of come up with this thing that we've called ACA mediation. And I think it's a very robust form of mediation in which we appoint people who have got a great deal of expertise in the area. And we create space for them to use that experience and expertise, not by telling the parties what they must do, because that isn't mediation, that's determination. But by in developing options for settlement, using that expertise to allow the parties to really go through the options in detail, say, look, if we just walked away, what would happen if we resiled? If we gave them a partnership, if we gave them a franchise, if we sort of rolled this up into a new JV, what would happen if we paid them this much and then changed the pricing structure on something else? All of those options are gone through really, really carefully, using a vast amount of experience that the mediator has got to help the parties clarify their thinking. And then doing the reality testing, say, well, look, you know, you've seen your expert report, you've seen their expert report, they quite obviously differ. I've had a look at these two experts' reports, and I've also read your previous correspondence. The other side are absolutely alive to these discrepancies. If you were to go to arbitration or to court, you'd be cross-examined on them vigorously. So how do you propose to sustain that argument that you're making? Because it's central to what you're doing. Because, you know, look, I've read it, and I've got 20 years in the field, and it's worrying me, okay? Now, we take the view that that level of expert intervention in the mediation process, short of telling the parties you will do this or you will do that, is in actual fact perfectly acceptable. And in fact, that is what the parties are asking us to do, and that is what we are training our mediators to do. And so far, with good effect. So we've called it ACRE. For those of you who are old enough to remember that ACRE was a measure of land before the metric system came in, it has a certain resonance. The analogy that I like for the analytical side is that if you look at countries like the States that use juries in civil trials, and you try and analyze what is a lawyer in a civil trial in front of a jury doing, the lawyer's job is to analyze the evidence. So that is the oral evidence, the documentary evidence, the experts' reports, the law, everything else, to empower the jury to make a proper, sensible, commercial decision in the matter. Our approach to mediation is to say the mediator's job is to do all that analysis in order to empower the parties to make a proper decision. That's the analogy that we use. So it's analytical, commercial, again, it recognizes, and I touched on this point earlier, it recognizes that the commercial realities facing the parties might be quite distinct from the narrow legal issue that they're still dealing with. We recognize that most commercial relationships, there's a limited number of suppliers, limited number of consumers. These parties will continue to trade with each other. Therefore, to restore that trading relationship is, where possible, is a very good idea. Expert, we've talked about originally. Now, the reason I put that slide up there, just in wrapping it up, is that these are precisely the qualities that we require the members of our conflict avoidance panels to have, because they are engaged in that process of trying to sort things out, get a pragmatic commercial settlement of as much as possible before having to actually give a written recommendation on the last aspect. And it's not only here, but I mean, we've moved recently into the planning sector, where again we're introducing a dispute resolution mechanism into Section 106 disputes, which is where you have got a dispute between a local authority and a developer relating to the provision of affordable housing, access to highways, all the sort of infrastructure stuff that goes when you build a new 200 houses somewhere. And they are at present being abused by both the local authorities and the contractor, so that you've got a 18 months, 2 years being delayed in 106 stage, whereas the government has a manifesto commitment to build houses in the UK. And so, you know, we've got a lot of pressure on us from number 10 to put a mechanism in place that will actually allow that to happen. And there again, what we're proposing is that you have somebody who comes in who uses this very robust mediation to get as much sorted as possible before actually giving a recommendation, which is then ultimately binding on the parties. So there we are. That is a sort of little canter through what we've been doing. Thank you very much for staying awake. It's been lovely talking to you. Thanks, Juan.
John, thank you very much. I don't know if there are any questions that...